don't bother me. I want the whole wide world to know that I love you so.
And welcome to Let Them Talk. I'm Paul DeRienzo.
And I'm Miss Joan Marie Moossy.
And we have a very interesting show today. I'd like to introduce staff attorney for the Partisan Defense Committee, Rachel Wolkenstein. Thank you for joining us, Rachel. We're going to be talking about Mumia Abu-Jamal. And I'll let you carry on the introduction, Johnny.
And Jean Herson,
who's the head of the
Labor Coordinator.
Labor Coordinator, right. I started out with the wrong word. We have it now. So something's happened recently, which is why we want to have this update show. So.
Right. To talk about Mumia Abu-Jamal, and I think we're hard-pressed to find anybody who doesn't know anything about Mumia Abu-Jamal, but there might still be folks out there who don't. So would somebody like to volunteer to tell us a little bit about
who he is, how we got to today?
Yeah.
Okay, well, Mumia Abu-Jamal is a black journalist, former Black Panther Party member, and MOVE supporter who's been on death row in Pennsylvania since 1982. He is known as the voice of the voiceless for his outspoken defense of humanity and his opposition to cop terror on the streets of Philadelphia and other things in which he's expressed his opposition to U.S. government policies.
And he's someone whose legal case is still ongoing.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we're here today because there was an ominous Supreme Court decision in his case just a week ago. And what happened in that decision is the court reversed an earlier 2001 decision that overturned Mumia's death sentence and actually reinstated the death sentence pending further discussion in the Third Circuit Court of Appeals, in which basically the Supreme Court gave marching orders to the Third Circuit to reinstate the death penalty for Mumia, to uphold it.
Now, why is it possible for someone to be on death row, have that taken away, and then be put back on death row? I mean, wouldn't that be double jeopardy?
No, it's the appeal process. And one of the things that's important to note is that the legal basis of the Supreme Court's rulings in a case called Spisak, and also in Mumia's case, is the 1996 Clinton administration law, the Effective Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act. Yeah. In which it's basically undermining the right to federal habeas corpus, the right for the federal courts to defend constitutional rights in opposition to what state courts are doing. And so Mumia's case here is another example of Mumia rules, very law that is being made that will have negative impact on everyone that is made in his case. And it has everything to do not only with the way the criminal justice system works, which is an injustice system, under capitalism, but also in the particulars of going after Mumia and seeking his death.
And why do you think it's so important for them to get Mumia put to death? I mean, do you think it's even possible after all these years?
Well, Mumia represents something very important in this society. He represents a threat to the system from their perception. Mumia, since he was 15 years old, has spoken out against racism, against police brutality, against victimization of the oppressed, and he has dedicated himself and his whole life has carried out to champion those people who do not have a voice, and he became known later as he became a professional journalist as the voice of the voiceless. He represents opposition to the system of profit and racial oppression in this society, and that is why he has been targeted for this long. The Partisan Defense Committee, our defense is based on a class analysis and a class defense. The Partisan Defense Committee is a class struggle, non-sectarian legal and social defense organization, which champions the cases and causes of all of the oppressed. And in accordance, we're initiated by and organized on in accordance with the views, the Marxist views of the Spartacist League. And we think that all working people, all people who are victimized, have to take up his case because it represents what all of us are suffering.
Now, there have been a lot of supporters of Mumia all over the world. And why do you think that hasn't
had an effect within the court system?
Well, I think it has everything to do with following what Jean said, is that we believe in a class struggle defense policy, which means no reliance on the capitalist courts, no illusions that the courts are going to provide justice, and the independence of working class mobilization from the capitalist courts or from Democratic or Republican Party, of course, politicians. And what has happened in Mumia's case is there's been effort after effort, and Mumia, supposedly on Mumia's behalf, that has actually sowed illusions in the courts. And that is through, been expressed most, I think, most clearly or simply in the fact that a lot of organizations have mobilized on the basis of a new trial for Mumia, seek a new trial for him, rather than understanding that he's an innocent man. He was framed up in a racist and politically biased way for the reasons Jean went through. And the only way to seek his freedom is to actually mobilize that power in society that can stop what's happening, which is the organized working class, and to do so without creating any illusions in the court system. And in Mumia's case, as the cases work through the court system for years and years, wave after wave of other organizations have demanded that that faith be put in the court process, and that has been a component of demobilization. And you add to that, you know, post September 11th, you have the current period we're in. You have, as I said, September 11th. You have the vacating of the death penalty. All of these things have actually been factored in.
I wanted to ask about that. I was curious if when his death penalty was vacated, whether the support dropped off to some degree, because I noticed at Mumia demonstrations there's often contingents of people who are particularly anti-death penalty as opposed to supporters of him in particular.
Well, I think there has been a component of that. I mean, we've put out pamphlets that talk about the fight to free Mumia and that Mumia is innocent, and at the same time, our initial entree into Mumia's case and back in 1987, over 2 decades ago, was understanding the need to fight against the death penalty, and we, you know, consider it legal lynching. And we have always struggled on Mumia's behalf, combining the fight for Mumia's freedom with the opposition to the death penalty, the racist death penalty. Now, so the death penalty has, for a lot of people who are not understanding the nature of the death penalty, nature of the capitalist system, has of course been something that has had various people viewed. If Mumia is not facing immediate death, then they're going to back away. But that has been exacerbated by policies by various organizations that keep on saying, in the next court, in the federal court, you know, say Judge Sabo is Judge Death, so we didn't get any good results in the Supreme Court in Pennsylvania or in the state courts in Pennsylvania, but in federal court we'll get a good decision. And when Joan reversed the death sentence, even though Mumia has never been off death row.
Oh, they did not change him to the general population.
No, never
okay,
been off the death
that.
Row since for
Ritual
his entire
Wolkenstein,
time.
Very interesting. I wanted to ask you a couple questions coming off of some of the things you said here. And also, as well, Jean Herson as well.
And also, let's give out information for anybody that wants to learn more about Mumia.
Right.
Too.
I'm Paul DeRienzo with Ms. Joan Marie Moossy. This is Let Them Talk, and we're talking about a very important decision that came down from the Supreme Court regarding the death penalty in the case of Mumia Abu-Jamal. What is it about Mumia that has created so much tension within the progressive community that you have folks who see it as a death penalty case, and then once it's passed the death penalty, they don't want to get involved in it? And I know, for example, a book was even written by one of maybe your colleagues, a former attorney of Mumia Abu-Jamal, that seemed to say that Mumia was in fact the shooter, that maybe it was self-defense, but he's never really maintained at any time what actually happened, in his own words anyway. What do you say to that?
Let me first of all answer or begin by answering by suggesting that people get in touch with the Partisan Defense Committee and can find this information, the answer to a lot of the questions you raised, Paul, in this pamphlet and on our webpage, which is partisandefense.org, mm-hmm. As well as contact the PDC at partisandefense@earthlink.net. Mm-hmm. Now, what you raise is very interesting. The fight for Mumia took place in the legal team as well as out in the more in the movement, as they call it. But we were fighting. We had lawyers, myself and another lawyer who was associated with the Partisan Defense Committee, believed very strongly that Mumia is an innocent man, that he was framed up. And we fought to present legal evidence in court over and over again to make it clear that Mumia was framed up and he was an innocent man. And that included the proof that witnesses were coerced and threatened into and bribed into speaking, being prosecution witnesses, that ballistics evidence was falsified, and that a confession that they said Mumia gave was totally fabricated by the police and the prosecution after Mumia filed charges for police brutality against them. But what happened there is basically a failure, a refusal to understand that Mumia's case, in a certain nutshell, actually epitomizes all the terror that goes on in capitalist society and all the legal injustices and the collusions that happen both formally and informally between the prosecution, the judiciary, and the police. And Mumia's case is a case of a frame-up of an innocent man. And what happened is we uncovered, got a confession from a man who said that he was the shooter. And he swore an affidavit. His basic position over what happened that night was backed up by tons of evidence that we had able to gather in the case.
Who was that person?
His name is Arnold Beverly. He is still alive. He has a sworn statement saying that he's the shooter. It was part and parcel of investigating the police corruption going on at the time, and that this case intersects that. And at the same time that Officer Faulkner was shot, there were actually three different federal investigations going on against the police that uncovered police and mob connections. And our presumption at the time was that Faulkner, not that he was a good guy of any sort, but he was nonetheless somebody who was making trouble, whether he was a formal informant for the FBI or the Justice Department or somewhat informally.
Some kind of whistleblower.
Whistleblower, we do not know. But the point is that Mumia was framed up in the course of Faulkner being targeted for death, and he was caught up in this, and he was a perfect target because the lead cops on the scene, in fact, were people who had been involved in against the Black Panther Party, mm-hmm. against the MOVE
so
organization.
They knew,
him, and they identified him immediately, and he went after him. And our fight for Mumia's freedom is tied up with both the fight against the death penalty, the understanding that both the innocent and the guilty get framed up and get sentenced to death, and we're opposed to the death sentence, and an understanding fundamentally that the capitalist courts serve the interests of the capitalist mm-hmm. class, and that the only way to fight for Mumia is with that understanding and fighting against that.
Mm-hmm. Now, can I ask a legal question? Because I'm fascinated. What exactly did the Supreme Court rule? You might have touched on it earlier, but for a legal fool as myself, what does it all mean? What does it all mean in legal, in layman's terms, what they did legally?
Well, what the court did is last April, first of all, there were two petitions for Mumia in the Supreme Court. One was to overturn his conviction based on the bias in the jury selection, and the court denied that last April. There was another petition from the DA's office to reinstate the death penalty. What the court did is they simply sat on the death penalty issue that the DA had raised while they heard a case called Spizak, who was a guy who's a Nazi, nothing like Mumia, of course, admitted that he committed some very heinous crimes. And his case had very similar issues, and the issue that was similar to Mumia's was the judge's charge to the jury on how they should deal with what they call mitigating circumstances in the sentencing. In other words, how the sentencing process went through. So they decided Spisak about 2 weeks ago, and what they decided there is that they would overturn a former Supreme Court decision called Mills and say that it did not apply in the particulars that were evident in Spisak's case. Now, Spisak and Mumia's case have some different nuances, difference legally and factually, but as Mumia said himself, is that law is really an expression of power, not an expression of what's right or what's wrong, and those that are in power want to see him dead. And
so this is a focus on the sentencing.
It's on the sentencing. Yes.
Tell me a little, Joni, you're the expert. What is it about Pennsylvania death law? How does that work?
Well, I actually worked on a death penalty case in Pennsylvania when I was in law school. And so there they have a trial, and then once they establish guilt, if they do, then they have a second, it's called a bifurcated trial. They have a second trial with the same jury to determine the sentence.
Right.
And so
and
this
that
has
was around the same time as Mumia.
Right.
So this part of the case has more to do with the sentencing.
It only
phase.
Has to do with
the
sentence.
Second part of
they,
the trial.
They have never gone back and allowed the basic conviction, proving his innocence, to allow to be revisited.
Right.
That's why this pamphlet that we have really definitively goes through every detail that proves his innocence.
That the court will not look at.
They will not. They have refused continuously to address that question at all. Now, we do believe in the need to take advantage of any possible redress in the legal system that's possible. However, the big danger in terms of Mumia's defense is to have illusions in the court system, because the court system, as Rachel just paraphrased Mumia, the court system is part of the whole capitalist system, its apparatus of repression, so that the capitalists can get profits. So what you have is the attempt to oppress people, exploit labor, smash trade unions, keep blacks imprisoned disproportionately. All of this serves the interests of the profit system in this country. That's why we emphasize, of course, all the community groups and the civil rights groups and the civil liberties groups and all of the other groups have mobilized, and we encourage them to take an action and take a stand for Mumia. But the trades have the power because they have the organized power of labor that can bring things to a stop in this society.
Where is labor on this?
Labor has been very...
Health care passed over.
Well...
Poorly, doing a poor job of it at that.
Well, in fact, that's one of the things that we have pointed out, the power of the state. Labor looked to Obama and the Democratic Party to solve their problems with health care. What did they get? They got a tax. The trade unions were going to be taxed to pay for the poor people, while the Wall Street people are just getting their bonuses. That's just one example. The ability to organize, the fact that the EFCA, means to facilitate organizing, has been completely shelved. Immigrant rights has
so
been completely
that the unions
shelved.
Are basically they should be involved in this, but they're falling down on the job. They're
well, no, the trade unions have taken a stand for Mumia. There are trade union locals across the country. I'm as labor coordinator of the Partisan Defense Committee, I've had contact with many unions, and we have representatives across the country and internationally. I happen to have been in South Africa addressing trade unions there in 1995 when the death warrant was signed for Mumia the first time. And we had a tremendous outpouring, and I had the opportunity to address 15,000 Kosatu trade unionists and to hear 15,000 trade unionists screaming, "Free Mumia Abu-Jamal," was one of the singular experiences of my life, and it shows what really has to happen. And in this country, there are locals in the Amalgamated Transit Workers Union, Communication Workers Union, the SEIU, AFSCME locals. In fact, in Philadelphia, the SEIU had an event for Mumia just a few blocks from where the whole incident where the police shot Mumia, and the police threw up a picket line around the Union Hall. They wanted so much to stop labor from taking a stand for Mumia. Mm-hmm. And this, so labor has been very active and very powerful. Right now, we want to emphasize that labor must not forget, and with the Supreme Court decision, to go back and reissue and put out new articles in their newspapers, to pass motions in their local meetings, and to keep Mumia's case alive and to educate people.
Can I have a copy? Let me see this. I want to show it closer to the camera. I want you to tell me where folks can get a copy of this.
You can get it from the Partisan Defense Committee. You can get it online. Most of the articles at partisandefense.org, or you can write to the Partisan Defense Committee at P.O. Box 99, Canal Street Station, 10013, or call the PDC 212-406-4252.
Okay. Rachel Wolkenstein, I would like to ask you now more about what is the... by the way, I'm Paul DeRienzo with Ms. Joan Marie Moossy. We have Herson and Rachel Wolkenstein from the Partisan Defense Committee. I always get that wrong. I was going to double check committee. And we're talking about the case of Mumia Abu-Jamal, very serious business here with a Supreme Court decision that might make it easier for the government and the enemies of Mumia to execute him. So we've been talking about that here in this show. And we're going to go on. I want to ask about what is it like for Mumia every day he's held on death row, because he is, continues to be on death row. And what is life on death row like? Have you had an opportunity to talk to him anytime recently? And can you tell us how he's doing?
Yes, I haven't spoken to him directly. I've spoken to his wife, and I visit Mumia on a regular basis. Mumia still describes his living conditions as living in a toilet, a bathroom, you know, a very small room with a toilet in it. He's got a few books there. He is confined in this cage 23 hours a day. He is allowed into, like, a yard 1 hour a day.
Now, why was he not moved out of death row when the decision
He wasn't moved out of death row because the federal court judge who overturned the death sentence nonetheless stayed his decision for the state to appeal everything. And so,
his situation really hadn't changed legally.
His situation has not changed at all. And Mumia is in isolation. He's allowed out into cages. When they exercise, they're taken in shackles. He's taken in shackles, both, you know, his feet and his arms. And he's taken out into another cage, really, with the top, all, you know, all the
literally,
sides on it.
Yeah.
And he's allowed periodically to play handball or something with one other guy. And that's really it. Sometimes he's allowed to go to the law library, and he's allowed to have visitors. And until very recently, within the past year, he had to come through to see visitors. In a room, he's in total isolation. There's no contact visits, not with family, not with lawyers, not with anything.
So there's glass between.
There's glass in between. He gets brought in on one side. You go in on another side. Again, it's a small room. He went through body cavity searches to come in when there's no contact visit.
To just have a visit.
And again, shackled. Now, Desmond Tutu visited about a year ago and saw and actually complained afterwards. And actually, Mumia now has the first time in, you know, some 28 years of being in prison, the ability when he sees visitors to not have his hands like this. And that's a recent thing, and other prisoners have gotten that too. But
it took an international incident to have that happen.
Yes, and it's a very dire, horrible situation. The medical care is terrible. He's not allowed to see his own doctors. He has medical problems right now.
How old is he now?
He's 55 years old, and he's been in prison more than half his life.
And I would even point out that while Mumia is on death row, right, shackles and everything, he has not stopped fighting for the oppressed.
Absolutely.
From death row, he has spoken out on countless issues, whether it's victimization of immigrants, whether it's the victimizations of people in the ghettos and barrios. But even on the trade union front, Mumia had a chance to go on television on ABC in the 90s, and there was a strike by IATSE workers. And he refused even to make the case and plead for his own life. He refused to go on television to honor the strike of those workers. He spoke out for the transit workers here in New York, understanding that the Taylor Law, which forbids strikes by any state or city worker, by public employees, was a criminal act, and that it was another example of oppression. He spoke out for the transit workers. So there have been many, many strikes, auto workers. From death row, he is still a participant, and his voice is very much alive, and that's why labor in particular, has the power, because labor is the one force in this society that can challenge the power of the capitalist system. So we're very much asking the people in the trade unions in particular, as well as all the other organizations, to keep his voice alive, to publicize his case, to have articles in the union newspaper. And we think that the petitions are very misguided. We disagree with groups like Workers World Party or Socialist Action.
Why is that?
Because the petitions are, not only is this a false avenue to appeal to the people that in fact are carrying out these acts of oppression against Mumia and want to see him executed, but the actual formulations in these petitions are particularly groveling to the very prisoners and executioners of Mumia, or the would-be, the people who want to do that. So we think we should look to the power in this society, the power of labor, as well as all the other community groups and civil liberty groups.
Now, after 3 minutes, go ahead.
After close to 30 years in this case, what do you think are the chances of him being executed or him being ever released?
I don't want to say right now. I have constantly been worried that he is going to be executed. They want to execute him. They're not stopping that at all, their efforts to do that. I've sat through courtroom after courtroom where the law, the letter of the law, appears to be on Mumia's side, but of course, given the way the courts work, it is not. It would take mass mobilization of labor in order to stay the executioner's hands. And that is not going to happen if people are relying on Obama or Eric Holder and acting as if these men who are representatives, in the case of Obama, commander-in-chief of U.S. imperialism, are going to aid and assist this man who has been a militant, a radical, views himself as a revolutionary, and has not stopped speaking out for people.
Let's get out the information one
yeah,
more
one
time,
because
we're just about to wrap up.
I'm surprised people didn't change their minds after the Leonard Peltier was not pardoned by Bill Clinton
yes,
after 8 years.
You're absolutely right.
And then Mark Rich gets pardoned.
That's right.
A criminal.
Well, those are examples.
All right, we don't have a lot of time.
Okay.
Go ahead and let's...
The Partisan, get this information.
Partisan Defense Committee, partisandefense.org, or contact us at partisandefense@earthlink.net. Call 212-406-4252 or write to Partisan Defense Committee at P.O. Box 99, Canal Street Station, 10013. Thank
you. Rachel Wolkenstein and Jean Harrison, thank you very much for joining us on Let Them Talk. And we're going to keep
Thank you for having us.
Keep up on this story. We're not going to let it go. We're going to be covering it in future. We want any
thank
new developments
to
cover it very, very closely. And one day maybe we'll have Mumia Abu-Jamal here on the
well,
stage.
Well, we're fighting for that.
All right.
Free Mumia.
Free Mumia.
Free Mumia.
And abolish the racist death penalty.
All right.